So hi, I'm Dale Kunce. I'm from the Red Cross, and I work for the International Services Division or Department. I'm not exactly clear on what the name is yet. We just call it ISD. And we focus on programs outside of the United States. And I'm going to talk a little bit about Red Cross's efforts around the world. And I feel like my talk is almost a little redundant after the last one, but hopefully not. I'm new here. This is my son, by the way. Go to bed, Owen. He's watching right now. I'm completely new. I'm completely new to OSM. I'm completely new to HOT. I'm really new to the humanitarian community. But I'm really excited to get a chance to participate in these communities. After years of toiling as a boring GIS analyst in really boring places. I've only been at the Red Cross for a couple weeks, but I've met some incredibly passionate people, and they're incredibly capable, but their programs are crying out for geo-goodness. A couple days ago, I was in a design charrette for a new Red Cross initiative, and staff said they wanted maps, they wanted maps, they wanted maps. When we tried to tease that out, they didn't know what that meant. They didn't know what it meant to have a map. We don't know what spatial is. We don't know, we have no staff. There's two people in the international division. There's one in the National Red Cross. And there were some dark days. People collected data, didn't know where it was gonna go. They had maps, or they wanted maps, but they didn't know what they wanted to do with them, just like these people in the meeting last week. And most of the Red Cross movement is still in the dark ages. The GIS and geospatial doesn't exist in most of the organization. Most of our time on my team is spent encouraging capacity and building capacity throughout the world and building up the OSM maps so that we can use them. And as you saw, everything changed for us in 2010 with the Haiti earthquake. It's a familiar story. We got our asses kicked, basically. We didn't know where we were going. We didn't know what we were doing. And we had no data. The NGOs were under incredible pressure to provide information we didn't have and couldn't provide. And the earthquake served as a major turning point for us, and I think for the larger OSM community in particular. As an example, I'm sure you guys have all seen this. This is Port-au-Prince the day before the earthquake in OSM. This is a couple days after, and this is Port-au-Prince today. So you can really see how OSM really contributed back to the community. And we now have a really good understanding of the reach and scope of Red Cross and where we are in the city in particular. And OSM helped a lot, but it still took a Red Cross a long time to catch up. The efforts of the OSM community helped them to sustain the GIS efforts for the next year and even today. I hear anecdotal evidence that the OSM maps are used in program initiatives even today. Red Cross is fundamentally a preparedness organization. While we do respond, and that gets a lot of the press, we really focus on the preparedness, especially in the international services. In Haiti, we simply responded to the disaster. Things might have been a little bit different if we'd prepared for it, if we had better base maps. And Haiti reinforced the need for those better maps before the disasters. And for our team, that means top-to-bottom training with OSM. Field methods first, you know, how to use a GPS, you know, walk the center line of the street, stand in the doorwell of a business, and how to create polygons. This slide shows some remote mapping that we started to do in Chile. And here we're tracking our stuff in JOSM when we get back. And we tried to be a little smart about it. This is our goat elevation model. It's a little hard to tell, but there's a GPS around the goat's neck there. And the Red Cross, we have really limited resources, and we tried to be innovative with those resources. And one of our staff members, Robert Bannock, came up with this idea, I believe over a couple beers with some local staff, with this idea of building an elevation model in a town using GPS point cloud data from the GPS, from the goat wandering up and down these really steep hills around the town. I don't think it actually worked. Not enough goats here. But the innovation is the important part, right? I mean, we're sort of embracing other ways to do stuff. We're not the typical GIS at the desktop anymore. We also employ college students at GW and at Tulane to do some really good remote mapping for us. They did some stuff in Indonesia and Colombia, and there was a great talk yesterday about it. And this collaboration was a huge success and one we want to keep doing with other groups. And this slide shows what we call a community vulnerability study. Here in, I think this is in Uganda, These folks are identifying the hazards in their communities. It's hard to tell, but like the colors of the yellow leaves and whatnot mean certain things. You know, that's a bridge or whatnot. And so we want to incorporate those vulnerabilities or those that local knowledge into OSM. And we want to take that community perception and the knowledge into OSM, because that perception is really important for us on the preparedness side. And we want to use the Red Cross access to these locales in our charter to prepare these organizations, and we want to do that through OSM. This is another example of a base map. This was done a couple days ago in Indonesia. Some more community mapping. We want to have OSM as the first thing that we use. This is my favorite cyclist, Mark Cavendish. So, two tenets of the Red Cross are impartiality and universality. And in part of these, we feel very strongly that the way forward is embrace open standards and open source software, and of course, OSM. OSM comes first because it's our foundation, it's our base map, and a lot of the time, it's our data store. It's where we actually put the information we're going to use day to day. And it's got to be our foundation. And we need a way to convert that passion and the local knowledge that we gather and have that data for ourselves and for other projects later. You heard a little bit about sustainability, and part of the international movement, a lot of places, a lot of companies or whoever will go places, and they'll bring something, and it doesn't stay. It's not there for the next community. OSM is really cheap, and there's no vendor lock-in, and it takes advantage of all the value-add work that we did during the project, and the remote mapping that folks like the college students are doing, so that we can actually prepare the organizations, prepare the communities, and that stays in the community. GIS is also a great recruiting tool for local volunteers with technical skills, so that we can maybe keep engaging them and they can become OSM contributors in the future. One of our challenges is getting OSM to work in these communities with sort of weird structures and weird road structures, and how do you classify a hut versus a normal house or whatnot. And these folks are craving for maps. This map is horrible, horrible. The most important part of this map, if you can see it, are the little tiny pink dots. I mean, whoever made this map thought that the elevation was the most important part. But they love this map. They use it every day. And it's a bad, bad map. The cartographer in me cries. And then we also, so this is some work we did in Gulu, Uganda. We did a huge effort to map Gulu remotely and locally. And we had several mapping parties and we did a lot of stuff. And after the base map was complete or nearly complete, remote, before we went to Gulu, we also coupled that with some community surveys and we did around a couple different things. Here, this map shows fire damage, I guess. And the gray is sort of where the surveys were taken, and the darker colors are where the severity of the fire was greater. So you can start to see some patterns emerge. This map shows diarrhea in the community. So same thing. So gray is where they did the surveys, and then darker brown, of course, is where the more cases of diarrhea are. And here we mapped the huts in Gulu. And this is really sort of a stark map. The huts correspond, it's sort of hard to tell because it's a couple slides later, but these correspond to the fire damage potential because it's the type of building that it is. And this data went straight into OSM. So you can see, this area here, yeah? Is this area here. So all those huts are now in OSM. We know where all this stuff is. And we respond to disasters as well. This is a current map of the stuff that the International Services Division is responding to right now. There's stuff in Syria, in China, Kenya, and Uganda. We don't know where we're gonna be next as far as responding to disasters. We can only try and plan for that. This is a map that shows every country or nation that has a National Red Cross Society. There's a couple gray spots on the map, but there's not many. We're everywhere, and we want to contribute everywhere. And OSM is a great everywhere tool for us to contribute to. We want to collaborate. I love this slide, by the way. We want to collaborate because that's traditionally been a problem for the NGOs. We silo the data ourselves. You know, a USA doesn't always talk to Red Cross, and Red Cross doesn't always talk to the British Red Cross. So, you know, like, we have our own internal problems. Even within the International Red Cross, inside of the American Red Cross, you know, data ends up in an office that I don't know about from another office. And we always need volunteers, just like HOT does. We need volunteers as well. You know, participate in a local mapping party, you know, go carry a sandbag, do your bit for your neighbors. Help people help people. That's really what we're in the business of doing. And we think that OSM is a foundation for that and is a great tool for us, because a better base map allows us to help people help people by improving our ability to prepare and respond to the disasters of any type, really. And I just want to say thank you to us OSM, because the projects we do now would not be successful without OSM. And that's what I got. So I will take a couple questions, but I do want to say, I've worked for Red Cross for 2 weeks, so if you can keep them really, really nice and easy, I'd appreciate it. Yeah, so the question is, what do we actually map when we map stuff? So do we map vulnerabilities or hazards, and do we map sort of the good stuff or the really important stuff after a hazard or say a sewer system or water or whatnot? We do both. We try, when we go somewhere, we try and map as much as possible. We try and be good members of the HOT community. You know, when we get somewhere, we want to map everything. And it's really important to know both of those things in responding to a disaster. It's important to know where the potable water is when a flood just wiped out the other potable water source for a town, and a small town especially. Yeah, so that's my job. I was hired to do that, to make our data that we've gathered, especially throughout the world, and then also to take our program data and our reporting data and make that a product. You know, this is going to sound a little weird, but, you know, at the Red Cross, our final client oftentimes is not the people that we're trying to help. It's our donor. And so we have to sort of help our donor help the people that we really want to help. And so our reporting tools have to get better. And that's why I was hired, sort of to make the data more accessible. Yeah, I don't know. I'm sure there's somebody else in the room from the HOT community that could better answer that. I would say that we at the Red Cross, we want to get to that point where we're putting up our own sort of tasking projects and whatnot. Sort of these are where we are at. We need a little bit of help here. I don't know too much about it, but I feel like that's where we're headed. Any other questions? Yeah, I mean, that's a wonderful question, and it's one I hope to have the next year at the next the answer for the next state of the map. I don't have it yet, but I would say from my experience that, you know, we want to have as much data as possible, and I think that's sort of OSM's idea, that sometimes OSM has too much data. You know, people always talk about sort of culling it and getting only the data that they want. So I think that for our perspective, we want to have as much data as possible. I don't know how to effectively map a refugee area. I'm sure there's people that have far more experience right now than I do that can answer that question. Any other questions? All right. Thank you.